Stay tuned for the Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Waiting to be profiled is writer Jon Stevens and artist Dean McCleary. Writer, producer, director Jon Stevens was born in Israel and raised in Brooklyn. He dropped out of high school to do what? Why did you drop out of high school?
I dropped out of high school because I could not speak the language.
Oh, is that right? You came when you were
I came here
older?
When I was 13, and I had a very difficult time learning English.
But you were in Brooklyn. Were there a lot of immigrants from there?
There were a lot of immigrants, but not from Israel in particular. And I did not fit in exactly. I come from a Middle Eastern background, and to come to Brooklyn was such an alien society for me. The only people I fit in with were Sicilians.
Oh, that's interesting, because I thought that was a hodgepodge of Israeli immigrants.
When I lived in Brooklyn, there were not too many Israelis. When I came there, there were Jewish Orthodox people whose background is European and my background is Middle Eastern. And I just did not fit in, but I fit in with the Italians just perfect because I look like them
and
they have a Mediterranean temper like me.
And food, and a lot of that is the same, isn't it? Well, when you dropped out, what did you do?
I went to work as a jeweler. I became a jeweler, Yemenite jewelry. Jewish people that come from Yemen are famous for handmade, very intricate jewelry.
Silver?
Gold.
Oh, and gold.
And I did that, and at night I started to take classes in acting, and that was a goal that I had, to become an actor.
So you wanted to be in movies somehow.
Yes, I went to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts. I also learned how to enrich my own vocabulary by, I read a lot, and I would copy down words, learn how to use them, memorize them, and that's how I enrich my vocabulary. And when I went to the American Academy, that helped me tremendously.
But that wasn't in your background.
No,
your family wasn't.
No,
so
not
you
at all.
Had to develop this all with your own goals.
Yes, yes.
So were you, when you went to the Academy, did you start writing then?
Well, what happened was a friend of mine and I optioned a book, and we hired.
You optioned?
We optioned a book for free, actually. Uh-huh. And then we looked for a screenwriter to write it without any money up front, of course. And we found a writer, and he was too slow, and our arrogance and ignorance, being young people, we said, we can write faster, let's get rid of him and we'll write the script, never realizing how hard it was.
Uh-huh.
And then I remember I called up the writer later on and I said, gee, I just didn't know how tough it was.
And how slow a process it is.
I apologized.
Oh, that was nice. So, but that was your beginning.
Correct.
And of getting into show business.
Yeah, and then I started writing more and rewriting and eventually got some jobs in production. I didn't have any idea yet that my goal was to be directing.
The reason I'm going through all of this is because you made a major film called Irish Whiskey. And I don't know what films you made up to this point or how you got to it, but the film is very professional and it was made on a very low budget, and we're going to talk about it. But I wanted to see what else you did on the way to this film.
Well, I started to work in commercials in New York.
Oh, so you got a feel of the camera then.
Yeah, and I worked my way up from being a production assistant to other jobs. The first job I ever had was I sent a letter and a resume to an Italian-American director, and I said, if you don't interview me for a job, I'm going to send the Cosa Nostra after you.
Did you really? You were
and he called me up. Yeah, and he called me up. He said, it took a lot of nerve to send me a letter like this. Come in, I want to meet you. And he gave me a job.
Uh-huh.
So, and then I moved to ABC Television and moved through the ranks into unit managing.
Did you do camera work? Did you do things like that?
I worked as a sound man for a while.
Did you?
Never as a cameraman.
You were on stage doing things.
And I eventually got a job at Fox as manager of production on primetime television.
Oh, so you did kind of slowly but slowly.
Yeah.
But you stayed in the business.
I stayed in the business, and I was a unit manager at ABC Television. And then I went to Israel for a couple of years and worked as a production manager there. But I must say, part of my training as a director is the fact that I was a production manager, and I was the world's lousiest production manager. But one thing I did learn, always be prepared, because as a production manager, I was always reacting to crises after they happen. But as a director, I learned to be prepared ahead of time to anticipate. So it helped me tremendously.
And then did Irish Whiskey, I'm going to just hold this book up because it has a picture of your three characters. Can you tell us a little bit about the film?
Irish Whiskey, I had a friend named Mick McGovern, and he was an unemployed actor, and obviously I was an unemployed director. And we decided to come up with a concept that nobody can stop from making. And at the same time, concurrently, I went to an Irish wedding and heard a wonderful Celtic rock group perform at the wedding. They're known as the Young Dubliners.
Oh, yes, because they play in your film.
Yes, and we decided, Mick and I, to write a story and place it among the Irish and write a wedding scene in there so that we can have the Young Dubliners perform in the film.
So you were on your way to making this movie.
Yeah. And
had you already written it?
Well, we wrote the script. We brought in Cassandra Naila Brown, who is a black actress I know. And she helped us develop her character. Once we had our script written, it took about a year altogether with rewrites. Mick McGovern moved to North Carolina. Cassandra Naila Brown eventually played in the film, and she did a wonderful job. What happened then, I tried to raise money for a couple of years, and I couldn't raise any money.
But it's about a dysfunctional family.
Yeah, the film basically is an updated version of All in the Family. You have Archie Bunker Millennium, who's the head of this Irish family in New Jersey.
Yeah.
And he's a politician, corrupt, and a bigot. Lo and behold, his younger brother shows up in the house with an African-American woman.
Right.
And creates fireworks in the family.
And one of the other people comes in with a physically challenged partner.
Yeah, his sister shows up with a disabled Sephardi Jew.
Yeah.
And but ultimately the film has a wonderful positive ending because it deals with overcoming our prejudgments about people and coming together as a family. And I know a lot about that because I was married to a Puerto Rican woman.
Let's see a little bit of that film. What do we have?
We have the trailer for the film.
Let's see that, and then let's talk some more about what it is.
Yes.
Great, Molly's here.
How you doing, Uncle Liam?
It's good to see everybody.
Oh, hi.
Thanksgiving.
This is gonna be good.
A time to gather with people we love.
Break out the fiddles and break out the pipes.
The Monahans.
How's it going to school?
A family.
3.7 GPA.
3.7? That's excellent.
I can do better. Let me get you a drink.
Separated by pride.
Mr. Judgmental here graduated top of his class.
Divided by prejudice.
Cassandra and I are getting married.
Michael, this is Cassandra.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Open your mouth about Cassandra again and I'll kick your ass.
Kept apart by perspective.
Michael is a good provider. Michael will make an excellent mayor.
He's an alcoholic, Brenda. He's like a walking time bomb.
You've never been any kind of father to us. You come home drunk every night. Mom never knows where you are, what bimbo you're with.
But united by tradition.
We're getting married today.
Across the distance of time.
It got greedy, womanizing, boozing.
Is all the heart.
Let me help you, pup.
the secrets.
I'm leaving, Frank.
What?
Molly, we're going in different directions.
He took a lesser paying job so you could go to school full time, and then you're gonna graduate and leave?
Molly, it's over.
And the place where tradition never ends.
I'm changing, Brenda.
And an American family.
So am I, Michael.
Begins again.
May the brother have the honor of a dance with the lovely bride.
Irish whiskey.
This is so professional. Was it all scripted?
All scripted. We did some improvisation in rehearsals. We made the whole film, 22-day shoot, 17 actors, 80 extras, 40 people in my crew, fed them all, did the music in Ireland. And we shot the whole movie. We did the whole film for $28,000 cash, $700,000 altogether.
It's amazing.
And then I could not get distribution. Tried for 5 years.
Let's hear about that, because I met you when you came to my daughter's door selling your film.
Right. What happened after trying to get distribution by conventional means for 5 years and it wasn't happening, by conventional wisdom, it was dead on arrival. No stars, no action, no sex, no
crashes.
You know, right. So I decided after 5 years I had to make a decision, quit, put it aside like some of my peers have done, or do something unconventional and extraordinary to attract attention to it. I decided to go sell my film door to door, sell 3,000 copies to prove it has an audience, even if it doesn't have all the quote unquote commercial ingredients. And I started 11 months ago. A lot of people thought I was crazy.
But you've almost gotten 3,000. You're almost there. Then once you get that, what are you going to do?
As of today, I'm at 2,654 copies. And when I have 3,000, I'm planning to go back to the distributors and show them my database, all handwritten, mm-hmm. grassroots style. All the people who buy the film sign my book. And I'm going to show them that I have overcome fear, suspicion, hatred for solicitors, iron gates, barking dogs, crying babies, closed windows.
That's
and
right.
I have sold my film, which means people want to see it. And they usually buy it on the pitch. So if I can create a sales campaign uh-huh. that gets people to pay me money, $15 at the door,
yeah.
If somebody can duplicate the marketing campaign I have been able to achieve at the door, people will come to the theater.
Right.
That's the whole point.
The idea was I didn't want to open the door to you. So we talked to you through the window. But I'm sure that happened a lot of times.
That has happened often. I've sold through the little windows in the door.
Right.
I put the video right through there.
But I don't want to go away without talking about the fact that you had such great directors. You thanked hundreds of people. You've been to a lot of film festivals with this. I saw this at a screening of the LA Teachers Association. It was very well attended. And in the end credits, you have people like Richard Benjamin supporting you.
I felt insecure about communicating with actors and decided I pitched the Directors Guild magazine on the idea that I would interview these actors who became directors because I felt they would know best about the subject of eliciting a terrific performance from an actor. And
so you had a list of them.
Yeah, so I went to Richard Benjamin first. He led me to Jodie Foster, who led me to Mel Gibson. And then I got to learn to Leonard Nimoy, Sidney Pollack. I had 10 directors all together, and I thanked them. And David Lynch gave me a lot of short ends, which is...
Oh, tell us really quickly, because our time has run out. Short ends are great.
Usually filmmakers have, on regular films, 1,000-foot rolls to shoot. We had 200-foot rolls, scraps from other filmmakers who helped us.
Just people giving you things.
Yes.
So they helped. Everyone pitched in and helped.
We had a lot of miracles. I'll give you one great miracle. One day, in location, I paid $5,000 for this house. We're out of money, out of food, out of film, didn't know what to do. The lady we rented the house from gave us the money back.
Oh, that was a miracle. And it was a miracle having you. I'm glad you came on. It really was meant to be.
Yes.
So thank you and good luck to Irish Whiskey.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
And don't go away. We'll be right back with the artist who did all of this work on the set, Dean McCreary. We'll be right back. I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome back to the Joan Quinn Profiles. I'm here with artist Dean McCreary, a Virgo who was born and raised in Northern California. After high school and college, he joined the Air Force. You were such a great athlete, and you dabbled in theater.
Right,
what
right.
were you doing in the Air Force?
You know, I ask myself that question every single day. I had nothing better to do. That's really what it boiled down to.
But you already were in theater.
Yes, I was. I grew up in the theater. My whole family was involved in theater. My father was the carpenter who built the sets. My mom still is a phenomenal actress. My sister Lori did the lighting. She also acted. My sister Penny as well. So it was.
Is that right?
Right.
All of that.
I was on stage at the age of four. And
now you're painting. Then you went in the service. So you weren't going to be in the theater in the service.
Well, I got out of theater when it got to be musicals. As I got older, as I became a teenager, it was all about the musicals. And I can't dance to save my life.
Can you sing?
No, I've been specifically asked not to sing in public by quite a few people.
But then after the service, you went to San Francisco Academy of Art.
Right, straight from the Air Force, right to the Academy of Art.
And you got a Bachelor of Fine Arts or a Master? I got a Bachelor of
BFA in Illustration. That's correct.
So you decided to be an illustrator.
You know, I was always fascinated by book covers. You know, the men swinging from lanyards with cutlasses and women with...
And that's what illustration meant to you.
Right, right. And so it was a fascinating world, and I love stories. I'm a storyteller. I've always been a storyteller.
That's your theatrical background.
I think that's what it is, absolutely. So these larger-than-life characters sort of drew me, and not having any experience other than drawing cartoons, I didn't know what I was getting myself into.
Was this going to be a career in illustration?
That was the thought, yes.
I'm going to show... Just to show,
yes.
Because we have oil paintings on the set, but I want to show you, show the people what your book covers look like.
One of my favorite illustrations. That is Boudica, Queen of the Iceni. I had a love affair with her for the last 20 years.
So did someone call you and say, I've written a book?
No,
do
this
the
was
cover?
This was actually a comp for a public a publisher. I wanted to show them what I was capable of doing. And it's a tough nut to crack. It's a very small group. It's a very tight-knit community.
When you started working on book cover, you actually did do book covers then.
Sure, yes I did.
And did you have any other part? Did you pick the typeface? Did you do anything that had to do inside?
No. There was space that needed to be left. There were some certain parameters that I had to follow. But once I sent off the artwork, it was out of my control.
Oh, so that was it. You just did. And this?
That's my father.
Ooh.
Yes, I used him as a model. I used some of my friends and family as models. But my father wanted me to paint a picture of a ram for him, and I had this great picture of him in a Hawaiian shirt. So I converted him to a Celtic chieftain, and actually this work I sent out to a publisher, and it got me two jobs.
So
it served its purpose well, and Dad, I'll get it back to you soon, I promise.
And then when did illustration leave you and book, when did illustration and books leave you and fine art come into your fine art, so we say, right?
What I realized in school is that in the illustration program, what I learned was really quick and dirty techniques instead of the actual how to paint, you know, how the master sat down to paint it. So the process of painting was beyond me, but I could fake it.
Mm-hmm. You mean from your illustration?
Right, from, you know, do little techniques. Absolutely, absolutely. I could step up with and look like I knew what I was doing. But it sort of left me flat because it was something that I was doing for other people. It wasn't stuff that I was really doing for myself. I didn't really feel that connection. And then one day I spent time with another marvelous painter, a very good friend of mine named Nathan Hessler up in San Francisco, and we started throwing paint, just portrait work. Very close up, very extreme poses.
These are very extreme. Look at me.
Right, right.
I love it.
That was so much fun. She's a very animated person. I love the extreme poses because for me life is not a static smile. My paintings are quirky. They're a little bit off in the proportions.
But it's hard to get into portraiture. Here you are talking about, you know, illustration and just starting in oil.
Right.
How could you adapt to portraiture?
I live life as life is a portrait for me. That sounds kind of cheesy, I know, and bear with me on this. But when I got into school, when I started seeing life as strokes of paint. I started trees, people's faces, the clouds, the way
You mean you just look, they look like paintings to
exactly.
you?
Exactly. It looked like, they look like techniques to me, you know, and life, there's so many things that are dark and you know, miserable about life, but there's some amazing things, and I choose to see that. You know, Rembrandt is a huge inspiration for me. And I
wondered about that, the dark colors
right,
are so great.
Yeah. I weep in front of his paintings because he got it right. He spent time with his subjects, and you can see it behind the eyes. He was he was their lover, he was their friend, he was their compatriot, he was...
It was you! But, so, the procedure on most of these are people you know.
Mostly, yes,
let's know. Let's start with Morgan down here. Morgan Freeman.
One of my favorite subjects to paint. I've done four pieces of him, and he has two of them.
And how did that come about?
My sister and he started a production company a number of years back called Revelations Entertainment. And so we met, I met through then, and it's just been, he's been a really...
Do you only paint people you know?
Yes.
I mean,
yes, because I get to go in and take the pictures. I love spending time. I came to your house and we took a series of photos. And I like spending time to get to know the person.
How you work is with photos and
right.
then you go back. You don't sit with the live model?
I haven't. The only things I do live are nudes.
So let's do, I'm glad you didn't ask me to do that. Let's do this one. Who's that?
This is my father. As I remember him, he's still with us.
This is great.
But this is
because this was him too, right?
Yes, he's another one of my
favorite
subjects.
That's great.
But I like to see the inner spirit of people, you know, and it comes out. There's again, I think it was Sargent who said that paintings or portraits of are people with something slightly wrong with the mouth.
Oh, but you know what portrait? But what artist? Who's this?
This is my friend Tom Esmeralda, a brilliant artist in his own right. Digital matte painter, quite an inspirational guy.
I think
guy.
What happens when painters do portraits, they put their own, something of their own feature in, always.
Happens constantly.
And what do you see? I see your nose in all
my,
of these.
My nose, absolutely.
Am I
yes,
right?
Yes, except for this one. This is
almost,
this
a little bit.
But still, yeah, my nose is in all of these pieces. In that.
So where do you think, it's true, where do you think portraiture will take you?
Oh. You know what? I haven't thought about that because for me, it's mostly about the process of sitting down with somebody that I've just met, yourself, somebody I know intimately, you know,
your
a member
dad,
of my family,
yeah.
and to be able to sit down and spend the time with them as I work on this portrait, as I work on the piece. It's about the process. It's not necessarily about the end result or about, I would like a rep, and I would
like
love to get into a gallery.
Uh-huh.
Absolutely.
But tell me, the difference in once you started working like with oil, this is mm-hmm. a very heavy oil painted
right.
Painterly compared to this softer,
it's been
flatter.
It's been an evolution, as you see from the book cover illustrations to this to something like this, which is really chunky. It's a freeing process for me.
This is great, isn't it? It was the last one you painted,
right? Yeah, absolutely. In fact, it's still moist, so don't touch. But yes, it's a departure for me to, I'm getting looser and looser in my style. And it's about life, it's about the process, it's about
who
really
did you
enjoying.
Study with, actually? Did these people have an influence on the oil paintings that you're doing, or was it more on the illustration than you?
Mostly more on the illustration, and I didn't really get the lessons that they were teaching. I was more concerned with the process and getting it right.
Because mm-hmm. I was making it look good.
Making it look good, exactly. And there was a wonderful illustrator painter named Craig Nelson, who I used to see his fantasy illustrations. I saw his movie posters he used to do. And when I walked into the classroom, I said, "You're that guy?"
Yeah.
And I was so ignorant at the time. I walked over after finishing. I took my oil brushes and walked over to the sink, turned on the water, and was trying to wash off the brushes. And I had red everywhere.
I love that story.
Came over and said, "Oil and water don't mix. Did you know that?" But he's a really true fine artist in with the oils. He's the one who got me sort of interested.
That's what's interesting is that so many painters don't know, haven't started from the beginning.
Right.
They don't know how to draw. Right. They don't know how to use the material.
Right.
And everything looks so easy because they think they can get out and do it.
It's like learning the scales of music, learning to draw, learning the basics. Is fundamental to be able to have your departure. Like, but you look at Picasso's early work. The stuff was great. He rendered things out. He was beautiful. You know, he really
but
had.
He always was doing that.
Absolutely.
I mean, he was always working as an artist.
Absolutely. And I'm.
And you're going
to
do it.
I hope to be always working as an artist. Well, something's wrong with my life if I'm not.
Keeping you painting, I think, is probably your screenwriting. You're doing a lot of screenwriting, which is like blowing my mind too, because
yes,
you
am.
Mentioned your sister,
right?
As a production.
Yes, she's a producer. I've been doing a lot of artwork for my sister as well, and she's certainly one of my biggest supporters creatively. My roommate and I wrote a screenplay, and I asked her, I said, would you like to read this? And she said, okay, great, here we go. Now my brother's asking me. So she, you know, she said a prayer over it, God, let this be good, and she read it and said, this is good. This is really good. So we're in development with it right now.
And it's about Venice, which I think is so interesting. And I think the other interesting thing is we have Morgan Freeman's portrait on the set.
Yes.
And he's starring in your film.
Well, he's not officially attached
yet. Oh, okay,
yet. Okay. We hope he's starring in it. We actually wrote the piece for him. With him in mind, because there's things we want to see him do in films that he doesn't do. And Chester and I is huge fans of his.
Chester
Hastings, he's my roommate and writing partner, yes, best friend.
And so it's about a person who starts in Venice.
Starts in modern-day San Francisco. He's sort of a dirty cop, transfers to modern-day Venice, and then Venice of the 14th century.
In Venice, Italy. Goes from California,
yes,
to Venice, Italy.
Well, to San Francisco,
yeah.
California, to Venice, Italy. So it weaves back and forth through time, and it's a series of paintings.
So this really goes back to your theater background,
yes,
being able to write,
yes,
and knowing what to do.
Absolutely.
And who to go to.
Absolutely. And it's, you know, that inner fire is, in fact, Joan, I'm doing a play.
Are you too? You're
yes,
acting in it?
I'm acting a play. It starts and opens in 3 weeks at the Raven Theater.
Oh, see? So we've gotten
about that,
so we've gotten full circle.
Absolutely.
Acting, painting, screenwriting.
Yes.
What else
yes.
did we leave out? Nothing.
Waiter? Archaeology.
Did you ever wait?
I never waited tables. Never waited tables. I don't remember what I order half the time, so I would not be a good waiter.
So you didn't wait on tables.
No,
but
no.
I think the Air Force probably gave you enough background that
yes, it did. Well, I'm 4 classes away from electronic engineering degree, so I have that to fall back on if the painting doesn't work out, or the writing,
or
the acting.
Or you can go paint the electronics people.
Yeah, painting the sides of aircraft.
Well, we're really happy that you were here.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
Dean McCreary.
I'm your biggest fan.
I love my portrait. It's fabulous. I love everything you brought today.
You've got two more coming.
Ooh,
it's a triptych.
It's a triptych.
Yes.
We'll put it on the set later.
Oh, great.
Okay.
Thank
you
so much.
Thank you for watching today. Keep riding to 777 South Figueroa, 44th floor, Los Angeles 917. We'll see you next time on the Joan Quinn Profiles. Yeah.